Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage, Oliver Zeigerman.
I'm Olli, I'm from Hamburg, Germany. I like Lithuanian beers and food. I am a software developer and I started doing machine learning a few years ago. This speech is about comparing classic machine learning strategies to deep learning strategies.
Welcome everyone. Everyone already knows who I am, so I can just jump right in and maybe take a few seconds for these gentlemen and ladies to sit. This is about comparing machine learning strategies, and I have quite a few, and this is actually impossible to do it in any detail, so I'm coming up with a trick. First of all, you probably know there's this Slido thing, and if you log in and then you punch in this hashtag, you will come to this conference, and this is Hall 6 now. This was originally scheduled for Hall 1, so this is now Hall 6. Okay. Good. I have an example for you. And this example is actually not a real example. It's a made-up one, but it could be real. So I made it so it could be a real example. Earlier I heard a question in the keynote, why is red always bad and green always good and yellow always something in the middle? And I have no idea. But it's the same thing here. So what you see on this page is customer data. It's fake customer data, but it could be real. How do you read that? So on the x-axis, this thing here, you have the age of customers, and on the y-axis, you have the maximum speed of the car of the customers. You might guess that this might be about car insurances, and it actually is. So it's about people having cars. And each of the spots on the screen represents one of the customers I actually have. That means, let's have a look. This spot up here, the green one, so the dark ones are green. The red ones are those in the middle, and the light ones are yellow. So let's look at this spot here. This represents one of my customers. He or she is 60 years old, and the speed of the car is around, let's see, almost 200. So it's a fast car, that's kilometers per hour, so it's not a bad car. Now, the color is the third dimension, and it encodes like how many accidents this current customer of mine was involved in. And green means good customer, and for an insurance, good customer means no accidents. Red means, like this for example, means quite a few accidents, and this means a bad customer for an insurance company. And yellow means something in the middle. So typically, you don't have the luxury of being able to plot your data sets in two dimensions because you typically have a lot of dimensions. And the third dimension might be how many miles per year you drive or how many years of driving experience you have, not your age. But because of this special talk that tries to explain a different kinds of machine learning, we restricted ourselves to two dimensions. Because two dimensions are the only thing I can properly plot on two dimensions. Well, and this thing happens to be two dimensions, the screen. So, let's get started. So, if I mean, it's a silly job, but say you are my employee, and I ask you, please draw lines in that picture to separate all the classes, like the red ones from the green ones and then from the yellow ones, but do it in a way that you don't make so many strokes. So the first line you might draw is this one. And then everything on the outside would be bad customers. And you already see it's inaccurate because a lot of them are misclassified. But this is always the case in machine learning, because if you want to generalize to unknown data, to new customers, then you always have to take into account that some of the data that you know you miscategorize. So this looks wrong, but it's by intention. So this is the red area. Now, I'm having two sections here for the somewhere in the middle customers. And then the rest is a green area. And we don't have to interpret this. So machine learning just works without any domain knowledge, without any interpretation. But you can interpret it as like, as I think I showed this example yesterday, and someone said, young people, fast cars, a lot of accidents. And then also young people in general tend to be worse drivers. And someone who's of my age is obviously a really good driver. And then people, yeah, it's a joke. people who do know me might tell. So, and this area here on the right side, this is for the people who are a little bit older. I think I might be one of the oldest people in the audience, so this probably doesn't apply to many of us. Not to me. So, you would never do this. I mean, if I gave you this assignment, please draw lines in the data sets, maybe you would ask me, why would I? But it's reasonable to explain something. And this thing that I was just drawing, and this thing, or these lines, they represent decision boundaries, or also sometimes called decision boundaries. Because if I make a decision, which of these parts is yellow and which of these parts is a green and which is red, they're actually the boundaries between these decisions. And the way they look like tell us a lot about the machine learning strategy when we apply the data to it. Keep in mind this drawing here, those decision boundaries, because we will see a lot of decision boundaries for the rest of the talk. And this is the trick of the talk. So we are looking at pictures like these and try to make sense of different machine learning strategies by looking at them, by looking at pictures. That's nice, right? No cat pictures, by the way. Sorry for that. So the core question is, that's what I said, we are dealing with supervised machine learning strategies. How would they, when you teach them, draw those boundaries? And this is not about like telling use this machine learning strategy or this, and this is the best, and this is not so much. I have an opinion about this, but I'm trying not to show it. Maybe I will try, and then at the end, if someone can guess. Hopefully not. So to find the best, what a strategy can do, there's something like brute force searches. You search over all kinds of parameters, and this is what we're going to do, if possible. You will see it's not always possible. The first library that we're using is called scikit-learn, and it's like the classic Python thing for classic machine learning. The second library that we're going to use is TensorFlow with Keras layers. And unfortunately, we will not be able to search the parameters automatically, so I hand-tuned it, but you will see. So, you probably already know, but this is the most important thing, generalization. If a model doesn't generalize well to unknown data, it's not a good model. And the robot here explains it. So this is the model, the shiny one. And you feed it a lot of sample data. This is known data. These are the data points that you saw. And now what you hope is when you feed in a new data point that you have never seen before, that this shiny box now is able to, even for this unknown data point, make a good prediction. And this is called generalization. And if a model doesn't generalize well, it's not a good model. So this is the objective that we are trying to optimize the model for, being general. That's important. Good. I will show code. I hope everyone is fine with that. A little bit, but mostly images. So the scikit-learn library is really very nice for comparison because it has a general API for all kinds of machine learning strategies. So for example, if you use a decision tree classifier, it will have a fit method to train it. You feed in like the age and the speed, and you feed in the label, and then it learns. And once you understand this interface, you understand the interface for all machine learning strategies, which is really nice. I very much appreciate that. And now, once you've trained it, you have this classifier object. This is a constructor call if you're interested. This is a method call. And this is another method call where you feed in previously unknown data and get the prediction out. So you would feed in something like 100 kilometers per hour, pretty slow, and then 30 years, and you get back group red, for example. So the good thing, as I said, is this is the same for all the machine learning libraries. So what you would do, what you typically do before you start this, is you to make sure that you're good at having good results, is that you're choosing a baseline. And a baseline is something that is extremely easy to compute. But it gives you an impression. So this baseline is random, was just randomly picking predictions. And this might not look familiar, but these are actually decision boundaries. But you have a lot of them. They're scattered all over the place. So they don't look like boundaries because you have extremely many. I think just by looking at this, you will immediately see this doesn't generalize well, that doesn't do anything well. But it still gets 33% of the predictions right. Because if you just guess, you have three possible guesses, one of them is right, the points are equally distributed, 33%. And if you run experiments with it, you will see that's the case. Funny sound. You want me to do it again? Anyway, often I also do something else, that I just write a few very simple rules and see how they would look like. This is, I express some rules. If someone is older than 75, probably not a good driver. If someone is young and has a fast car, also not a good driver. And then if someone just young without a fast car in the middle. You see it's totally inaccurate, but this is not the point. The point is how does a rule-based system draw the decision boundaries? And as you can see, those are just blocks, they're lines. Because that's what you can do with it, like if else, for example. Which might be interesting. So all you can draw with something like this is lines. So now let's have a look at the first real machine learning algorithm. And if you look at rules like those that I described before, you can look at them as some sort of decision tree. And at each part of the decision tree, you didn't expect I could zoom in, right? Quite nice, isn't it? So this is a really high resolution, it's real. There's the first decision that I'm taking. I'm saying if the speed is less than 146, then I go to the left side, and then I'm saying this is yellow. This is the yellow category. And then on the right side, I make another split, the next decision. Now I'm looking for the speed of the car. So if it's not, then I go to this side, and if it is, I go to this side. And then the next decision I'm making is about the age. And so on, until I find the leaves of such a decision, which would be the return statement in business logic, for example. Now, the important thing about this, I was afraid I couldn't zoom out again, but I can. The important thing about this is, it's a real decision tree, but I have not programmed it. This has been learned by one of the classifiers. And how does this work? So, this decision tree classifier takes either random or best, or some of the features, in this case the age, and then it computes something from that age that's called a combined Gini cost. And Gini cost is not something that's specific to machine learning, that's a measure of like how disturbed a collection is, how many differences are in a collection. And it tries to minimize that combined cost. Like it tries to separate the groups so that they are all the same. And then we are trying to minimize for that. And this is extremely brutal. Like the simplest algorithm is very brutal. You just go through all the values and you just choose the lowest one. And this is the split For example, for the first split, it could have been that they're splitting around the age of maybe 70. No, that would be rather 50, I would say. So this is the first split. And then again and again until you reach all the leaves of the tree. This is how this could look like. And this, again, I have to emphasize, is the best result I could come up with. And it's optimized for generalization. And what's interesting is it's still blocks, because that's the nature of this algorithm. You can only have blocks. It might be fine blocks, but they are blocks. That means you never see something like a really smooth decision boundary you cannot produce. Or if you produce it, it's extremely likely that it doesn't generalize well. You also see mistakes, but it's still interesting. It's not a bad model. But as I said, it's not about comparing these models. And because of that, I left out the scores for the models. But I'm telling you, it's not the best. Good, this is decision trees. Let's look at the code. And this code, if you've never seen this, is really interesting. And this is like the silver bullet. It's really super code, because in the line 6, you have something called that's called grid search. And what it does, it takes one of these classifiers, it sticks in all the possible combinations of all the parameters that I'm putting up there, and tries out which one is the best. And it does it by cross-validation. That means it always checks for best generalization. And this is actually, I didn't leave out any line, this is actually the code. So you're fitting with this grid search thing, and what you describe is the depth of the tree. That means you need to know that the parameter that impacts the performance of the tree is the depth of the tree, the maximum depth. And this can be between 2 and 25. And 25 levels going down is quite a huge tree. And then it's also like, how if you have a certain amount of samples in that classify for leaf. How many of them do you need to have to still split that thing? And then eventually, this thing here, how many samples do you need at least in a leaf? And this varies between 1 and 11, and this varies between 2 and 11. And those values are a bit random. That's the weak part, because you can't search over all values in the world, so you need to restrict it to something reasonable. So now it tries out all the possible combinations, and you might guess, if you let it run on many CPUs, if this is not fast, it will not work, but it is fast. So decision tree classifiers train in a fraction of a second, microseconds sometimes, depending on the amount of data, to be honest. So this is the end result. Max depth is 6, determined by this thing here. This plots the best parameters. Minimum leaf size for split is 3, and minimum samples for a node is 2. No work invested. This is a few minutes of coding. And the result you already saw. Okay, next one. This also is plotted by decision trees, but this time using an ensemble of decision trees. That means you have a lot of decision trees and you combine the results of them. It typically has a better shape, and in this case it's almost true except for this thing here, which is really surprising. But it typically is better, that means it generalizes well. And better often means the borders are a little bit more smooth. And it tries its best, but let's see if you can compare it to the other version. This is the decision tree version. I need to be really fast. I think I wasn't fast enough. But just by looking at this, this actually is a better result. And ensemble methods, like random forest, tend to generalize much better. Code for it, I'm not going into too many details because it's very simple. The important part is, or most important part is, that you specify how many individual decision trees do you want at most, and they will be combined later. And I'm saying between 3 and 20. And it's also that we no longer can do a grid search on just normal hardware because it's just too expensive. Decision trees take much longer to train. Random forest takes much longer to train. So in this case, we chose a randomized search. That means it picks 1,000 randomized parameters and tries which one is the best. And you don't get the best result, but you might get a reasonable result. So this is the end result. We get 12 estimators and the other parameters, well, that's just what it is. What's interesting is that the maximum depth, like how many nestings do you have in the decisions, is just 5, which isn't a lot, which is nice. Good, going on. There's one more interesting classic one, which is called K-nearest neighbor. And almost no one uses it, but it's really nice because it's very simple. Let's skip this and just have a look at the visualization, because I have it. Oops. Okay, good. Wait, I misscrolled. Good. These areas here, it's a little bit different of the colors, so forgive me for that. I adapted another example. These colors, they mean the same. They are plotting the background. Those are the decision boundaries, and these are the data points. And the algorithm works like this. It takes a number of k's, in this case, 6, but we can use 3. And then if you try to make a prediction, it takes the next 3 neighbors, the closest neighbors in this case, and checks what color do they have. And then there's a majority vote. In this case, we have 2 of the color blue and 1 of the color red. That means the vote for this specific point where the mouse pointer is here is blue. And what's also interesting is that you can change the number of neighbors. When you do, the result changes dramatically. For example, like this, this looks like a much better decision boundary because it's much more smooth. You don't have a lot of islands. This thing here is still broken. But it looks like a much better prediction if you use something like, how many? 8 neighbors. And this is the main parameter that you want to change. This thing is good, so k-nearest neighbor is good, because it's extremely easy to understand. It's almost impossible not to understand it. If you don't understand it, it's my problem, not yours, so I didn't explain it well. But it is also a little bit strange because in order for it to work, you need to have all the data. So it doesn't actually do abstraction. And in times of the GDPR, it's a little bit tough to deliver a model that contains all the data points. But it also has another benefit that it's always pretty easy to explain how you came to a conclusion. So sometimes it's necessary to explain why you came to a certain conclusion. Let's see. And let's say I'm making this prediction. And then someone asks, how did you come to that conclusion? Then I can tell people, I have 2 other data points that are very similar to this one, and I know for sure that they are this classification. And that's the reason why you're also in that group. And then you can check, how's that possible? Is it wrong? I mean, how did you, are these data points right at all? So this is pretty good if you need an explanation. Good. That's k-nearest neighbor. Thank you. Let's look at the plot. Again, I did a grid search, and it turned out 23 neighbors, which is quite a bit, actually give a good result. And this looks good. This looks pretty good. It's pretty smooth, even though k-nearest neighbor tends to have islands like these. It's not great. You will see greater models, and you will just by looking at it, understand that other models are better. But this one is reasonably good. I think we're skipping this because it might be tiring, except for one detail. Like how you weight a certain neighbor can be uniform. That means it doesn't matter how far the neighbor is away. It always has the same say in it, the same weight. Or you can weight by distance. And surprisingly, I'm really surprised, the grid search revealed that uniform, like every neighbor is equally important, is the better measure, which I didn't expect. But that's how it is. Now for something that is often misunderstood, because it's named in a bad way, and that's support vector machines. Support vector machines are not machines. It's a machine learning strategy. And it used to be like the best machine learning strategy before a deep learning showed up on the scene. Let's see. So they're called support vector machines because they don't use all the data points that we have to draw a decision boundary, but only support vectors. That means some of the data points that are close to the decision boundary, which is quite nice. And then you have two tunable parameters, which are extremely hard to understand, and then also pretty hard to tell from each other. The first one is gamma, and it explains how far away from the decision boundary do you want to like take support vectors into account. And I'm skipping this. And the other one is cost, and this is cost for misclassified data point. And the intuition is if you use high cost, this thing tends to overfit, and low cost means that you're regularizing well, which means you generalize better. Because this is actually pretty hard to understand, someone came up with the playground where you can tune, because it's now zoomed in, I need to find, yes, where you can tune the cost, that means maybe high cost for high cost for something misclassified, and then you see really strange decision boundaries, like big decision boundaries. And then it plays along with a gamma, so you typically adjust both of them. And that is, I should have prepared something that's more reasonable here, so I'm just randomly playing around and I'm surprised by myself what I see. But this is what you can do to understand how this decision boundary here is drawn. But in theory it would mean like if the cost is high for something that's misclassified, which is the case here, it should be really wiggly, the decision boundary, but as I'm posing it with a strong gamma, it seems to be okay, which is very surprising for me. So, let's see. So, this is the result of a support vector machine. Again, I searched for a gamma and cost using grid search, and this is as good as it gets, more or less. It's extremely smooth, just a very few strokes. There are no islands. This might be the only glitch. But if you see something like this, that's so smooth, you will immediately know this must be a good model. Finally, coming to something that's a little bit hotter today, which is the deep learning stuff. And now we are leaving the area of scikit-learn, but are in the domain of TensorFlow. And the basic element, the unit of a neural network is something that's called artificial neuron. It has a certain amount of inputs and a single output. And this thing now represents the whole neuron. And it works by just adding up all the inputs together. But before we do it, we multiply by individual weights. So these are the inputs, the weights. We sum that up. And in the end, we add a constant. This is not quite it. We also have something that's called an activation function, which is inspired by how people thought the brain would work in the 70s of the last century. And this could be different functions. But on the x-axis here, you get the input of this formula. And on the y-axis, you get the real output of that neuron. This one is called sigmoid. And it's like compressing all the possible output values between 0 and 1. That's a common one. Now, what you can do, you combine these neurons to complexer networks. And as this is very visual, as you can see, I prepared this playground, which is the TensorFlow playground. And the TensorFlow playground lets you play around with neural networks and lets you organize them in layers, one layer, second layer, and you have a certain number of neurons in that. And then you train that. That means you tweak the parameters of that network by minimizing the error on that side here. And as you can see on this example, it gives a very good result. This is how it basically works. And I totally recommend you to play with this tool because it can be so much fun. And you learn so much about neural networks. You can change the number of neurons per layer. You can change the number of layers up here. You change the activation function. If you know a little bit more than I told you, then you will know that there's a learning rate which defines how fast it learns. And there's also more stuff, like regularization. Pretty cool, and it's all in one page. So, if you don't know what you're doing, then you scroll down, and then you get some explanations. It's pretty good. So, let's see, how does it do? And I haven't copied this, but this is extremely close to what the support vector machine can do. We have this island here, which is worse, but then we have that don't have that glitch here. And the scores for them are almost the same. They're almost exactly the same for neural networks and the support vector machine. Quite nice. How does it look like in code? Oops, sorry. This is the setup of the neural network. And this is a more clumsy way of specifying what you also can do in the TensorFlow playground. That means I have two layers, first layer, second layer, and each layer of 100 neurons. And this stuff in between is just to make it generalize better, which I can't explain in the scope of this course. And this is the activation function, which is different from sigmoid, but just something. And this is just the output of the thing. This is the whole configuration of the network. But you still see it's much more code than for all the other strategies. And I had to like tweak this manually. It took quite a while. Maybe this took around a day to actually get a good model. For the others, it took 5 minutes. I made a post about this. This was like, this is a little bit off topic, but this was my first scientific conference where I was showing a poster and I had no idea how to do this. So this is what I came up with. And everyone liked it because it was wrong. That's not how you do a poster, you know. That everyone who did a scientific poster knows this is not what they expect. But it was still fun. Anyway, I did all the comparisons here. Doesn't matter too much. And then if you want to play with it yourself, which is possible, I have all the code in this notebook. And I think I have a few minutes to very briefly show this to you. I have, right? I have a few minutes. 5 minutes? Okay. Oh, quite good. Because this tool that I'm showing you now is also, if you really want to dive into it, it's indispensable for you. This tool is hosted by Google, and it allows you to have a zero installation environment for experiments. It has scikit-learn pre-installed, it has TensorFlow in its latest version pre-installed, and you just write some code. If you know what a notebook is, you know what this is. If not, I will show you. And you can execute each part of the code individually. Now it's running this cell up there. I'm very sorry. I mean, I can't help it. And then you can execute some code. And then we download the data and so on and so on. What you also can see is the scroll bar. That means pure size of this notebook is immense because it explains all the concepts in detail and it does all the plots. And it gives you more stuff like how you train it, how you regularize. So this is like my condensed knowledge of machine learning in a single notebook. So, sometimes I try to sell consulting services. Maybe I shouldn't tell people too much about it, because they just go there, and then it's probably less annoying than having me around. But anyway, this is not a sales pitch, so I'm happy to show you this. If this is interesting, if this speaks to you, go to that notebook and try it out. So with this, I'm closing in time, as it seems. I'm wrapping up. The trick that I applied, which was not my idea, to be honest. You saw the visualization of decision boundaries in many other tools, but I deliberately restricted myself to more or less the decision boundary. And I think if you look at a lot of them, they will start speaking to you. I said I won't say my opinion, but it's right on the slide. I know that deep learning is very attractive for a lot of people because it's a new thing, and support vector machines are 10 years old. But often, all you might need is classic machine learning. And it's often so much less bugging you. It's often really sufficient, but it's not cool. But if you do something that's images, or you do texts, or sequences, like, I don't know, any time sequence, any text, anything that contains pictures, you probably can't avoid using deep neural networks. With this, we can come to questions. Are there questions? In the audience. That's very hard for me to see. Maybe people can help me.
I think no. So
good.
Go to slide.
Good. It's very hard to read this from here, surprisingly. That's the first question. You well, guess how you do this. Maybe the person who asked it come to me later and I can give more detailed advice. But you get it by doing what I'm doing now. Or you write a blog post. Or you, I don't know, you get visible. And you have to be visible, because otherwise people don't find you. And if you might be a shy person, that's perfect, because you don't have to talk to people actively, but they will come to you and ask you, will you do something for us? Which, admittedly, is a very, very comfortable situation. So, but then if you're a shy person, you probably don't want to stand here, then you might want to write a blog post or write a book. Good. I think that's answered. Well, you can't fight back, so I just define it answered. Oh, okay. This question, I failed the central plot of the talk. Oh no. So I thought it was obvious from, I've tried all the time saying, and now I show you that this I did by automatically finding all the parameters in a few minutes. It just took me 5 minutes to get the classic machine learning working, and the neural network, it took me a day. I don't know what to say. They are, actually, I have to say this, they're actually really good, the results. I never had it that the results of a neural network were actually worse than the results of something else, if I invested a lot of time. So to be really fair, if you have a lot of time, if you have infinite time to spend, and you want absolutely the best results, and you want to be a little bit in control, yes, use that. But from my experience, people want quick results with the least cost possible. And if you want that, and you don't have pictures, and you don't have text, then maybe it's not the best decision to have a neural network. On the flip side, marketing-wise, deep learning is just, you have to use it at a certain point. If I come to someone and tell them, let's solve this with classic machine learning, would say, no, you want the cool stuff. You can't do this for us? Then the trick that I apply is, I say, yes, let's try deep learning. And then they will see, oh, we need a GPU, which is expensive, and it doesn't train like good this. And then I say at a certain point, oh, I'm giving away all my tricks. at a certain point, I tell them, is this on video? Can we cut this out later? So. now it's too late anyway. So at a certain point, I tell them, okay, let's try something else as a baseline. Let's try support vector machines. And they say, oh, this is outstanding results. And we had this in 5 minutes. Why not use this? And then I say, maybe that's a good idea. And well, maybe you can pay someone money not to like publish this, but now I've said it. Yes. Okay, good. This is answered by my definition. Huh? No, we had this? wrong. No, my favorite ML model is support vector machines. But random forest is the first thing that I try, because it often gives good results. Answered. Good. That's fun. How much time do we have left? A few minutes?
4 minutes.
Four minutes. Good. So what platforms are good? Not quite sure if I understand the question right. If it is what frameworks, I think I answered this. This would be scikit-learn, and then TensorFlow, and then maybe also PyTorch, which is something academic people like because it's very flexible. If you mean deployment and going into production, which is it this? Someone talking to me? No? Good. Fair enough. I mean, that's the tool, I understand. It's a one-way tool. So I'm understanding platform as, I don't know how to bring this in production. And TensorFlow is a really good story because you can deploy TensorFlow models in cloud-based services. Where you don't even have to provide or provision the server. You just push the model over to Google if you trust Google with it. Or you can run TensorFlow in the TensorFlow serving mode, or the TensorFlow serving tool, which you provide the model with, and then it just starts, and you have a server that you can make REST calls to, and you get back answers. Scikit-learn has a little bit more tricky question when it comes to production, because you would need, it's a Python, you would need to set up probably a Flask web server and then come up with the API yourself, but it's still doable. TensorFlow also has one really good feature, is that you can convert your TensorFlow model to JavaScript, which sounds like a silly idea, but then you are able to deploy your model directly in the browser, make it run on the machine of your user somewhere, on this GPU here, on this, well, on my phone GPU, which is also quite nice. Not sure, okay. Oh yeah, this is, what are your strategies for avoiding overfitting? This is like, this could be a whole talk all by itself. The strategies depend on the machine learning strategies. But I think I showed that. So you tweak the parameters, like cost and then gamma, or the number of neighbors for k-nearest neighbor, and by that you fight overfitting. And then for machine learning, sorry, for the deep learning for the neural networks, I had dropout, I had batch normalization, I had smaller capacity of models, I had limited iterations on training, and I think that's it. Okay, final question? Oh no, no, not a... can I have another one? Is that possible, or is it against the rules? Can I answer another one? I'm really sorry. So, but one thing I want to say is that the TensorFlow stuff, the API from the TensorFlow stuff, it's very similar from Python to R. So it's almost like at first glance it almost looks the same. Okay. Okay, what about AutoML? Good. Just recently, I think 2 weeks ago, I like this question. So I'm answering this question, not the question that you have. That feels good. So just 2 weeks ago, Google released something for neural networks that can automatically tweak the parameters of the network. But because this is so costly if you do it brute force, they implemented a reinforcement learning approach. I haven't tried it, but people tell me it's good. It's really brilliant. And you can make it run on your local machine or on the cloud. And this is what I will try. If I ever repeat this talk, I will use this and see if it actually does what it should. Okay, so.
So thank you, Oliver. And we have a gift for you.